ahead and get started. I'm gonna start by showing you, I'm gonna change the cam over so you can see my other camera. Graphite the back, okay? So if you haven't done that, go ahead and do that. I'm gonna make sure that I can see this. All right, so I think she's ready. I'm gonna trace it on here. One thing you wanna make sure when you're working this way is that you tape your surface onto whatever board. So I've just got a table here that I'm working from because I'm not gonna move it. Obviously, if you're gonna move it, I would highly suggest that you get a board that is that you can move around. Now that I've got that, I'm gonna go over some large areas, okay? And I actually like to use a pen on this, but since I've got a pencil, it's fine. I think I'm almost about ready. Okay, I want you to look. So this is Mario Robinson, and I'm showing you him because he is a watercolor artist, and we're gonna kind of use his technique because what I find is that his technique is more conducive to learning how to start from a drawing and then adding paint on top. So this is an image of Mario. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna start out with, you see this very light wash? Can you guys see that? Let's see if I can zoom in more. Can you see this light wash though? You see how light it is? I mean, it's so minute. So we're gonna start out with basically doing a simple black and white. If you want to change Maya Angelou's photo into a black and white, you can do that on your phone, or you can just visually think about it in value. So we're gonna start out with basically taking a little bit, instead of black, we're gonna use blue. And so we're gonna slowly build it up from the blue up. All right, so the next image is now he's gonna start adding color. Do you see that? So we're gonna have this black and white image. We're gonna let it dry a little bit, maybe work on the background, and then we're gonna slowly add color. So here's one that he's add color to it a little bit more, and he's building up slowly, okay? So the slower you are with watercolor, the better. But the thing you wanna watch out for is that this is a specific technique. So some of you who might want it more watery, I like to say, or create edges that are softer. Some of his are soft, but I would say his edges are a little harder than maybe some of the other watercolor artists would like it to be. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. So you can see the difference between the two, where the image on to the left and then the image to the right, where you can see how he is adding, slowly building up his flesh tone or his skin tone. Okay. So I've got everything laid out. I'm gonna move my lens this way, pack that up, put droplets on my watercolor. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna start out with this because everybody else has it. I'm gonna make sure that I get the image of Maya off so I can see her as well. I want you to really think about, when I look at this image, you wanna figure out what is the lightest lights in here, all right? So that's one thing that my master painter would tell me is, what is the lightest light on here, Sisavan? The lightest light is probably right on her forehead, and whatever image you're using, definitely the dot of her eyes, right? Okay, around that area. And just a few highlights on the pearls, but definitely if we're paying attention to the face, it's that forehead. You can't get any lighter than light. Does that make sense? And lighter that area. So you want to keep that area as white as possible, the color of your paper. Don't touch that area, all right? So that's why we've isolated. If you look at it here, I have isolated this area so I can see where my whitest white is, all right? Now, some of you, if you do a black and white on like an Instagram or on your photo, you can then really get to see the values. If you're having problems with values, I would highly suggest you do a bunch of value studies and just throw your image onto your iPhone and just change it to black and white, because you don't have a direction of light. And light is what we're painting over a form. And so you need to remember that without light, there's no form. And so if, again, I'm looking at Maya, I'm gonna look at this and say, this is the lightest light right here. Next to her is a medium value. Next to that is a medium dark and then a dark, right? Now, her skin tone actually is almost like a greenish blue. What they would call that is her cool colors or her non-color. Her really rich color is really almost like a cad red with a lizard crimson on it, okay? Okay, so, but what we're gonna do is we're gonna do that simple monochrome or achromatic, depending on if you just use black and white. And we're gonna start with that. I'm gonna take the cerulean blue and I'm gonna see if you guys can see that. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start to add it to this area to keep it fairly. Can you kind of see that? And it's going to be light. Remember that image I showed you, how light it was? It's very light. Now, if you don't want a blue, you don't have to. Actually, I think I'm going to touch a little bit of a darker blue. I'm gonna put a little bit of a dark in here because I feel like it's almost a little too cool. I'm gonna make it that gray like he did. So let's, if there's an area that you messed up on, I would take my Q-tip, all right? And I can move it around. Do you see that? And I can pick up paint as well and water as well. Again, I want to be careful because there's a highlight right here. I'm going to take my Q-tip and lightly take off. Now, I know some of you guys ask about frisket. I'm going to show you frisket after I'm done with this. But if you have a large area that's really white, that would be the only part where I would really put frisket at. The other thing is I am going to put it right where her pupil is at the lightest light, okay? And maybe I'll put some on the pearls, and that's it. Okay, it's actually fairly expensive, but you can, I mean, you don't need a ton of it, all right? So what I'm gonna do actually is I am gonna take a different brush and not this brush. One thing I wanna do is you put a little bit of dish soap in here. If you do not put dish soap in, you're screwed, all right? So you wanna put dish soap in here and water. You see it's bubbly? That's what you want. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put that down. I'll go ahead and use this, it doesn't matter. I'm gonna dip it right in there anyway. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just dip it in the frisket and I'm gonna dot it where the lights are at. I'm just gonna kind of play with it and really think about where that light might be at. What it's gonna do is gonna dry hard, okay? The trick to this though is that make sure you put it in that soapy brush if you are finished. That's all I'm gonna do. Okay, I don't know if you can see that, but it's really light. I'm gonna put my brush right into the soapy water. Because if I don't do that, that brush is ruined. And then I'm gonna dip it back into the clean water. Okay, so that's Frisket. I'm gonna keep going with her and build up my darks, and then we're gonna add color pretty soon here. Go in this area right here. I use my pinky to put it on there. The other thing I like to use, I was gonna show you guys, is either a mall stick. Some people use a mall stick to go over the form. Put it somewhere. I created one of these. It's really quite simple. If you look at it, it's a piece of wood with an attachment on it. And so what you could do is then put it over here, and then you can work on an area. So that's like a tabletop mall stick, okay? You can make one. If you don't make one, if you can't make one, what you can do is just put two books on the side and a piece of like even a ruler, okay? Yeah, I mean, this isn't fancy, but I will tell you, the older I get, I need to steady my hands, and not enough coffee or tea will like steady my hands. And so I will use this technique. Again, I have a couple students, alumni who are in here. They know I'm very efficient. I don't like to just go out and buy stuff if I don't have to. But all these workshops I've been to, it's like these little tricks that they teach you. And then, you know, some of them, they just want you to buy stuff. And so I find that you just have to be careful with your budget, with supplies. So I'm gonna go in and just kind of establish a little bit the harder edges for her earrings. And if I look at it, there's like a middle value right there. So I'm gonna go ahead and put her, be careful my edges are still soft. So I always really practice taking water off. If you're done with this class and you wanna get better at watercolor, learning to take water off and the pigment off of from your brush is like, you know, a very good technique to learn. Okay, are we ready for color? What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna quickly take a shot of this. Kind of nice to see, like, you know, what you need to work on, the edges, or it needs to get darker. So on your palette, I wanna make sure that you establish a cool and a warm area. Don't like start to muddy everything, all right? This is where I start talking about muddy colors, cool and warm, remembering that, you know, your complements as well, because that will lower intensity of the paint. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna start off with the darks. Why not? Okay, so since we started out with darks, now if your area on your face, some of it is too wet, don't work on that area or else it's gonna bleed everywhere, all right? You don't want it to bleed everywhere. You better work on an area that's dry. That's the only thing about, you get impatient. You're like, but it's watercolor. Why don't we dry faster? The other thing is that you can use a blow dryer, but you have to be very careful with your blow dryer because you can blow that paint right to the edge and it creates a hard edge, all right? So honestly, have a cup of tea or coffee and just wait for the thing to dry. Let's go in with a little bit of your alizarin crimson. I'm gonna touch it a little bit with the brown. It looks like a burnt umber, okay? So what I'm doing is this establishing a dark color. Because she's not Caucasian, that the only part that I call mom that is clean that we might call the flesh color that we're usually used to seeing is this in her forehead. Do you see that? Okay, it's a very clean, simple, I call it mom color, where it's a simple flesh color. But everybody, I think, that has different ethnicity, unless they're really, really dark, they won't have this kind of pinkish flesh tone. But most of the time you will. So what I'm gonna do is take a little bit of the brown, the burnt umber, with a touch of alizarin crimson. So what you're doing is establishing a warm and a cool, but really a warm dark. So just because you mix your paint on here doesn't mean you really don't know what it's gonna do here. Do you understand? Because you've got cool undertone already over here. If you wanted to start with a yellow, you could. That would be a warm undertone painting. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just start on the forehead and I'm gonna start adding color. Got yellow ochre and sienna, so I'm gonna start adding the yellow. So right here is like a yellow ochre on my palette on this traveling thing. Instead of going for intense yellow, I'm gonna go for yellow ochre again because her skin tone is much darker. Raw sienna also works really well for darker skin tone, and her undertone has some, I would say that's like a terra vert green right here as well. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna add a little bit of yellow into these other redder areas. Again, if you were to paint Caucasian or Asian or somebody who's a little lighter, I would probably start with a yellow and build up on top. What you always do, but everybody's skin tone is a bit different. It makes the world go around. Okay, but I'd rather you start slow and not rush it then bum rush it. Glazing is what I'm doing. Is I'm glazing right on top of the values that we created with the cool underpainting. I'm gonna go ahead and put a little yellow in there, but what I'm gonna do is then touch it with a little red and a little blue, and that's going to give me that metal look, the metallic look that I want. So I'm going in and just giving some harder edges to some of this. This is the fun part where you actually get to detail a little bit more. I call it fun. Some people find that very stressful. Okay, so the masking fluid, how do you take your masking fluid off? You can take an eraser. I had one. You can take an eraser where the eyeball's at. I'm just gonna lightly pull it up. And then right over here as well. So now you can kind of, do you see her hair somewhat, the light in her hair? So see about taking this camera off, but it's really saturated and the detail, I wanted to show you the hair. You see the hair? how saturated these colors are. The lip area right here. You're watching your, watch your side of your jewelry, because you really want that area light so then it turns. And if I go down, we're gonna work on the pearls a little bit and darken her up even more so. I'm gonna put the camera back up. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take my smaller brush, and because there's oranges and reds and things like that in this area, because gray hair isn't just black and white, all right? It's the same thing with anything else that is light, it absorbs the light. So this area, I'm gonna build up that area with some of my yellow ochre that I already have on here. So I'm gonna take it and really just put it in these spots. Now I'm gonna start to kind of create and wisp that hair, but maybe not kill it to death, maybe not paint every hair. I'm gonna do is soften this area up a little bit. I'm going to just create these curls. So I'm just kind of, you know, just letting my brush do its thing, but kind of directing it. And that's kind of what hair does anyways. I'm gonna keep making sure I don't lose all my lights that I, you know, spent time putting the masking fluid on there. One thing don't forget about is the reflection on the pearls. One thing, it's free, so you don't have to pay for anything. And the other thing is I would be happy. You could send me an image of your thing and say, hey, Sisavon, what did I do wrong? And I'd tell you. So you definitely can email me at sisavon.houghton@mtsu.edu. Just want to build up just a little bit more. Again, to recap, a darker skin tone, yellow ochre, raw sienna. Cerulean kind of helps it, but just so you go slow, but phthalo blue, French ultramarine, phthalo blue. I mean, phthalo blue has warm in it. And so you got to be careful how much you put on there. And I can tell even in mine, like I can add more saturation, there's more color, there's more nuances. And again, classical painting is drawing first. Your drawing's not good, your painting doesn't matter how great your colors are. Like you can manipulate color a little bit, you can change color a little bit. Dry brushing is great for like building up the texture area, for instance, like rocks or the side of a wall. It's great for also like on animals, because animals have a lot of fur on them. And so what you want to do is just kind of add some dry brushing, and that will really create that volume. And you can keep glazing with that dry brushing, because then it suggests detail. Some of the darks around her muzzle area a little bit over here. I'm gonna push her lips just a little bit more. Get a little alizarin crimson back in there and darken up this part of her lip. Again, if you don't know the anatomy, you don't know the face, you definitely could work on that a little bit more. You feel like you're just not very good at it. I'm taking in my little tiny brush, I mean the same brush I've been using, and just going in and finding the lip. And that's my detail. I'll go in with a little bit of darker red. So this really is the fun part. And I actually might finish this today. Okay, dry brushing. I'm gonna switch over to, you can use that brush, but I'm gonna switch to a natural hair. It's actually really great because it will hold the paint, it will grab onto the paint a bit better. And this is actually a long brush. I would actually probably take a bright, if you know what a bright is, it's basically a flat but shorter. And I would actually chop off like 2/3 of it off. And that what happens is they have those brushes you can buy, you can scumble it with it. So what I'm doing is I took a little bit of there, making this noise. And actually I want a lot off, but what I'm doing is I'm taking this brush, I'm gonna see if I took enough off. It's gonna create this softness for me. I don't know if you can see that. So in this area over here, I'm gonna take a little bit of more. I'm gonna pounce on, it's kind of dry here, but it's kind of wet because I couldn't pick anything up if I kept it really dry. I'm gonna take it on her hair, like over here, and I'm gonna create this texture and just kind of pouncing on there, and it's gonna create this soft without it all just looking like one streaky spot. So I'm gonna take it and scumble. Again, pouncing, take a little off, pounce, off, bring it back over here to create this kind of dry brush. What it does, it pushes some of those curls back and makes it look soft for hair. Now it softens it up a little bit. So take a little bit of paint, bring it back over here, wherever you're doing it at, and kind of round it out and use the side of your brush and not just the tip, or else you'll ruin your brushes. The other part is you really could do it on her, where the skin starts to turn over of each other, right? Instead of having an abrupt change, goes eh, because our face isn't it's really soft and pliable and malleable. This is where the part where my students used to say, she makes it look so easy. That Mario Robinson guy actually uses a lot of dry brushing. If you look at his work, there's some beautiful softness that happened, but you really can only get that softness by dry brushing. So we've got 10 minutes. Do you see the richness in color that you guys don't see, that I see? I want you to see that, because like when I see it on there, it's really dull, and the painting's not that dull. So there's a lot of richness that's happening in the painting that, again, you just don't get to see. So looking at the two, I definitely build up the colors a little bit more. I would definitely push the darks around her, work on the pearls. But now if you really look at it closely, do you see the area right here? If you can see it where I scumbled and dry brushed, you see how it kind of looks fuzzy? Well, that's what dry brushing is. It's kind of fuzzy. And the more you build up on top of that fuzz, you create the hair. And even if she has tight curls for being African-American, she's still gonna have fuzz. Even I have fuzz in my hair, and I bet you have fuzzy hair as well. And so creating that illusion of depth is really kind of what I was talking about. Okay, so I'm gonna maybe go back. So I wanna give you some idea of how it looks from my perspective. And like I said, 20% lighter in watercolor, I definitely would keep pushing it a little bit more. But remember, this isn't oils, this is watercolor, you understand? And so the same principle in the way that you treat watercolor is very different from oils or acrylic. I have, and if you've worked with all the different mediums, you'll understand that that's, you can't treat them the same, is all I can say. Let's see, I'm just trying to move that around. I'm gonna go back. I think that's all. I hope you guys have a great day. Happy painting.